You consume what newspaper you want, whether you want to read the Daily Mail, the Times, the Guardian, you know, the Independent, etc. And that might go with your political allegiances, but it also might influence those who maybe aren't as astute in terms of realising what they want. From a broadcasting point of view, we are regulated, so we have to be fair and balanced. I can guarantee you on any given day, particularly during a general election, but frankly on stories like, you know, the murder of Lee Rigby or, for instance, the terror attacks that we've seen recently, I can guarantee you I can walk out of the news at just before 7 o'clock in the evening and I can do an unscientific search of Twitter and find people who, if it's politically minded, that a political story is dominated by those news. You know, some people will say Robert Peston has been biased for the Tories, and some people will say Robert Peston has been biased against the Tories if it's on a terror attack that we've, you know, portrayed it in a certain way. Well, do you know what? If somebody's unhappy with what I've done, go and complain to Ofcom, and Ofcom will investigate us, and I'll have to justify every single dot and comma of what we have broadcast that day. I don't think the British public would want unregulated TV broadcasts. I don't think you'd want any Fox News in the UK. I do think, I go back to what I said at the start, you know, we have a responsibility. Certainly ourselves and the BBC have a responsibility to make sure that what we do is fair, balanced, correctly researched, absolutely told through people's eyes. I too remember covering Fred West many years ago, but telling it in a fair, balanced way. Will everybody agree? No. When I ran Granada, as many people would complain that I was biased against Manchester United, as people would say I was biased against Liverpool. My view was always half the audience is complaining I'm biased for
Thank you very much indeed, Richard, and thank you. The lady in the purple top, I hope that's the correct colour. Yeah, thank you. Cheers. What's your name?
Maria Shaw.
Thank you, Maria. Who's your question for?
Well, sort of carrying on from what you were saying earlier about internships, you said 2 to 4 weeks, and that really should be it. There seems to be a lot of my son's just graduated. He's just finished at Lincoln doing a journalism course, and there are an awful lot of internships that he's, you know, he can come down to London, do this, do that. He could do all sorts of different things possibly, but I think it's unfair and I think it's wrong. It seems to me, well, maybe I'm just biased because I'm his mother, but it does seem wrong that a lot of this seems to be free labour. They're getting a lot of work out of somebody, and you know they've got to go and live down in London. As you were saying, a lot of it is down the south, and it is unfortunately.
I 100% agree with you. And as a northerner doing my MA, I was doing jobs to just save up money so that I could afford to be able to do the internships. I was lucky because I had friends that lived in London. I could go and stay with them when I was doing internships. But we have a scheme. A lot of publishers agree with this. So a lot of publishers will open up their houses and let people stay whilst they're doing an internship because they recognise that it's ridiculously expensive to live in London. And you just, if you're not being paid to do something, then you know the cost of living somewhere is ridiculous. So it is a problem. I personally think, yeah, it shouldn't happen. People should be paid to do work experience. But if it's just a couple of weeks and up to a month, then you get an amazing range of experience. We have months at Bloomsbury, and actually that gives you a good chance to really get to know people and get to know the mix of what you're doing. And it's up to you to really make the most of that. And then, you know, you get to know people in the team. We all know people that work in different publishing houses. And we'll let you know when there's an assistant job come up. And we'll even act as referees for you. So, you know, it's not a perfect system. And that's why I'd say try and avoid the 6 months to a year, because that is actually just slaving, quite frankly. But, you know, don't just, you know, make the most of it when you do have the opportunity. And, you know, make sure you're going. If you're local, this place is local. So you have to be proactive and you have to be knocking on the door. And you do have to make a good impression if you're gonna work in the industry now. That's the hard truth of it.
As a journalist, I mean, I'm simply behind, you know, proper wages for people. I'm not making a political comment or anything like that. But you can't underestimate, as a journalist, as a startup journalist, as you say, you're a journalist, how important it is to make contacts and get your CV going, and to get your first byline, and your name seen. And I still do it now, you know, with certain journalism. For example, I was with the editor of the Western Gazette recently, and he said, "Have you heard of user-generated content?" And I said, "No, go on." He said, "Well, basically, we can't afford to take on staff anymore, so we just try and persuade people to send us their text, send us their articles, write articles for free, send us their JPEGs, high-quality JPEGs, for free. They can get the name in, and they can get their credit on the thing." But, and I thought, oh, you know, this is terrible. And this, of course, the newspapers are getting their money from advertising. So, so a lot has been squeezed. But you know, even 20 odd years ago, when I was trying to get into journalism, I couldn't allow myself to be so precious as to say absolutely no more than 1 month am I prepared to work here, because every day is valuable for contacts, making contacts, getting a name. And I came out of my work at the Journal at the Guardian, paid nothing for it, having been paid nothing. With countless violins that I traded off for years to get myself up to Netflix work. It sounds terribly kind of humiliating, but it's not, because it's very valuable to get into really bespoke places and very valuable to meet other people who are, and you can spend your whole life applying for jobs in these places. You spend your whole life trying to persuade someone who gave you work experience to take you on full time. But a lot of these places don't do it, particularly nowadays. Particularly, I suspect, in journalism, which is squeezed ever more than it was. And so I'm not advocating go to people and do things for free, but when you are starting out, certainly be careful about not being too precious and crucial. Make sure you can fund yourself. Don't rely on the job itself to fund you. Moonlight or have some savings, whatever. I'm sorry that sounds counter to what you're saying, and I don't want it to, but there are no rules in journalism. Just go for it, and don't be ashamed to not ask for money, but really, really dine out on your bylines and the contacts you make on LinkedIn and all that kind of stuff. My opinion, although I'm a different generation from your son, my opinion, that's still a good way to do it.
Well, I
think
journalism is different because you can build a portfolio and prove what you do.
Work, and then a week's work turns into a month's work, and then a month's work turns into a year's work.
It's hard. You've got to be persistent. Sometimes that persistence will pay off. You're absolutely right. I think we all agree. Never take a job that is, here's a 6-month contract, you're not going to get paid a B. Yeah. They're absolutely ripping you off. That's a bad employer. Don't go and work for them. However, you know, this summer, I wouldn't be going on holiday to Ibiza or to New York or wherever. Right? It's used this summer to get that experience. But somewhere along the line, you'll get a break. Yeah. And don't apologise to being a proud, pushy parent. If my mum had kicked me up the backside 30-odd years ago, I wouldn't be in the job that I am now.
There you go. Thank you. Very good question. Right, we've got time for a few more. Who'd like to, perhaps on this side of the room? Oh, there we are. Well, have you got one? We've got one, just the young lady in the burgundy red wine top, and then a lady at the very back end of the white top, a darkish top. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Julia. I'm doing a PhD in creative writing. I just wanted to know advice on when is the right time to get a literary agent, what advice do you have? I'm kind of starting my first novel and I've got a few published. I have a poetry chapbook, so poetry is also not very easy to publish, so just general advice.
Well, if you don't mind, Jim, I'm going to pass this to the pyjama man, if that's all right. Thank you, Paul, and then we'll come back.
I've got sorts of thoughts about this. When I used to look after MA courses, you'd have all the agents wanting to come and talk to all the students, and the first place I was at UEA, two agencies were allowed to come. That was it. And they'd come and they'd cream off the people they wanted. And then they started to want to do bursaries, so they wanted to meet people earlier in the year. And then they wanted to meet the students before they began the course, and they wanted to look at the application forms. So my time spent saying, bugger off to it. You are not getting to them before they've had a year and a half, 2 years, I think it's a 2-year course. You're not going to see them until they're ready, and I'm not going to let you cause chaos on my course. Because, of course, people were getting deals. People were getting these ridiculous deals. Because it was the era of people being given £250,000 for two novels, and of course you never saw them again. You bought these things. And so I just pushed them back. And also, we had to have all the agencies. I wasn't just having two. So it never happened again, but I fought for this thing 1 year. We had the agents' tea party, and we took over the Sainsbury's Centre and had tables set out. And rather than the agents coming to talk, to talk down to the whole of the MS, just the MS students, I invited all of them, and all the agents had a table each, and we poured in every crit for our students, the undergraduates and the PhDs as well, and let the students move around, so the agents were pitching it down, which just shifted the dynamic completely, and it was hilarious. But it also gave the students a sense of power, because you forget, it's not you sending in trying to kind of get the attention of the students, they're looking for people all the time, they're looking for the work all the time, they want, not every agent is right for every writing. You're looking for this kind of this matchmaking thing, and so a bit of speed lit, and it seemed like the way to do it to me, and it meant lots and lots of conversations were happening. It's not this thing of the great gods come down to descend on the students, and if you're lucky enough, you're going to if you stand out, you get picked up by them, and there's a lot of that. So I just think it happens, and there's a different narrative for every single writer. It's a very odd thing. And you've just got to send things out and meet people. Make sure you meet people face to face as well. I think you can't do it not. I was with my first agent, I was very, very loyal to, and I knew her because she was a friend of a friend. She was a friend of the partner of my PhD supervisor. And it's the first person you hear of when I was an agent. Oh my God, isn't that? And actually, it's kind of a wrong choice in a way. I was kind of loyal and didn't meet for a while, and it's kind of too late by that. You've got to make sure that it's somebody who can fight for you, and on your side no matter what, and knows what you're up to. And it's I hate that word passionate, everybody uses the word passionate about their careers now, but actually can show a bit of passion for what you're doing and understand it. And more than that, can articulate that to other people. That's the important part, isn't it? To actually find yourself being represented by somebody, it means something. So, in some ways, I mean, I was 20 when I was first kind of looking for an agent, it took till I was 24, and it seemed like the longest 4 years of my life. But in some ways, I wish I got lots of offers once from other agents once I saw my first. Oh, once I got my first review to the Guardian, and I just said, no, no, it's very high-minded way, I'm loyal to the person who's shown interest for 4 years. I won't do that now. Just you've got to be a bit more ruthless, I think, than I shop around. You're interviewing them, they're not interviewing you. Make them think they're interviewing you. I think that's the way to do it. Be nice. But actually, you're looking at a few of them, you're thinking, who will do the work for me? You're paying them. You know, up to 20% of foreign deals, 15% on usual deals. So be hard-hearted and ruthless and make them work.
Can I ask you, Paul, because I've never had an agent.
Get one.
I'm quite happy to have an agent. And I think for a lot of people, they don't quite know what agents do. So what does your agent do for you that you can't or prefer not to do for yourself?
Money. It's all contract stuff. For me, there's lots of other things they do. But actually going through a contract, combing through, and looking at all those clauses that I have a clue about, never want to. I rely on him to do that, but also bump up his price. Bump up the price I get for the whole thing to cover his percentage. And if you do that, it's working for nothing for me, I'm happy. But he covers the legalistic part of it and all the kind of contractual stuff. And we'll talk hard stuff with the publisher that, you know, I can pretend I have nothing to do with. You haven't got to have those
options.
Yeah, I mean, there's something I'm doing. I'm doing actually some illustration work, and I was thinking he's not handling that part of my world, so I'll talk direct to the small press. And so I'm saying that's a shit percentage, and realise that these conversations I never have, because I've always had an agent, and it's actually quite refreshing to go back to the publisher and say in quite kind of hard nosed way, no, you want me, you need to do it in the next month, I'm not taking that percentage. Quite like to, but I've never usually had this conversation with your agent. Does that? It's quite, I mean, it's good because then otherwise we have these difficult conversations with your editor. And if you're there, going to talk about a book, and stuff, you don't be arguing about the rights to this, that, you know, so, which I guess that's what you're doing. If you're covering the whole thing yourself,
I am a member of the Society of Authors, who are brilliant and bargain. So I pay them about £100 a year.
Yeah,
it's not much, and.
They are,
if you send them a copy of your prospective contract, they get back to you in 2-3 days with really detailed notes on this is fine, you might want to ask about this is rubbish. In my case, they don't normally say it's rubbish because I tend to get quite good ones. So I have a good relationship with my publisher. But it's a great way if you don't want to be spending, you don't want to be getting 10%, 15%, 20% to an agent for doing that, then it's cheaper.
Could you just say the name again? I don't think you're on who.
It's the Society of Authors. You do have to be published or about to be published, so you need to kind of get in a bit to be able to be a member. So it's not, you can't just join by paying the money. But if you're a certain way along, they're a really good option. I can't speak highly enough.
Thank you. We promised the lady at the back with the laptop. Thank you. Thanks, Paul.
Hi, I'm Dana. I'm a second year journalism student. So this time next year we'll be around the town and I might start looking for jobs and everything else. And I know that it's going to be a struggle. So is it best to make myself stand out and really go to town on what I really want to report and what's important to me? Or will that cause
definitely, it's interesting because I think you mentioned I've spoken to a few of the publishing students and the journalism students at UCLAB and that also. And what I was impressed with amongst many things was some of you who were already at a very young age specialising in and kind of going into it out of this, there's the word passion again, but because you're passionate about something and it's something you know about and love. which is great. I didn't do it that way. I just ended up kind of, as I said, falling into news journalism, which you couldn't get broad around. And then, but I did specialise in journalism, of course, in music later on. But in my opinion, you could do either, you do well, but always good start to go with something you love. So if you have a real interest in knowledge and contacts within, you know, like, for example, there's a few sports journalists on there doing courses here, and I was dead impressed with some of the guys who just kind of, you know, you could tell they knew their stuff, and they were interested in writing. I would never know or want to write about sports journalism, but they, you know, that's where their interest lay. So it really helps to drive you, and it helps to build your confidence as well, because you're so kind of broad in your, well, I like being a journalist. It doesn't help necessarily unless you get in with the right people. But yeah, so to specialise is good. What is your, do you have a specialisation?
Well, I don't really have it yet, but it's like I'd really want to be part of a place in the world that maybe I could be part of as much. So tonight, right. Channel 4 doing a programme on the Body World.
Yeah.
Like, that's really like what I'm really interested in.
from a broadcast point of view, the reality is when you first start in the industry, you're not going to go straight into a specialist area. You know, I started in local radio, doing everything from, you know, around here, for a road, 1999, doing anything from a terrible murder through to a, you know, woman celebrating her 100th birthday as an on fire. The starting point is you get yourself some experience. Once you've got that experience, absolutely, if there is an area of broadcasting you want to specialise in, then that's how you make contacts in the industry. You find out what's the best route to that programme or to that area, you know, and you can work on it. Having said that, you know, I reported for 15 years before I moved on to the other side of the newsroom and dealt with alcohol. You know, I travelled the world. I went to Afghanistan, I went to Iraq, I went to football World Cups, I covered stories in America, you know, I did terrible murders around the UK, I did all manner of things. And I couldn't have specialised in any one of those if that was my passion. I actually just enjoyed covering stories for what they were. There is a demand and a desire for that. It is a really tough beat to get into because, you know, lots of people want to do it. It doesn't mean, just because you work in general news, that you won't get those opportunities. But when you start in broadcasting, the reality is you're going to work in a local radio station or you're going to work in a local TV station, and you'll be expected to cover anything from, you know, the lead story to the unfinding. You then use that experience from what the pressures are about covering those stories to build up your portfolio, to build up your interest, to make contacts in the wider industry, which then get you your next opportunity, whether that's on a specialist programme. So, for instance, you know, I remember employing people at Granada who are now running children's TV, working on Coronation Street, you know, working in Network News, working at Channel 4 News, you know, working with me down at ITV News. So get your foot in the door, get the experience in broadcasting, and then go out and specialise. So, for instance, the biggest mistake, here's a tip if you apply to the ITV trainee scheme next year, right? 1,200 people apply, 12 people get it, right? It's applying for a local TV trainee scheme. So people who write in their application form that I'm interested in covering what's going on in Africa or Syria or, you know, the Far East, etc. That ain't going to be what you're going to cover. You know, when you're covering what are the problems with bins in Darwin or, you know, what the local council in Torquay is doing, you know, it doesn't matter that you've got an interest in what's going on in the other reporting world. That might be what you end up doing in the long term, but in the short term, focus on what you do now. So don't put that on your application form. Put your application form down as what you're interested in and what that training scheme is about.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great sign that it's gone so fast because we've really had some information, some great conversation here, but unfortunately time has caught up with us. But I just want to say a big thank you to the panel, and can I ask you to give them a round of applause, please? We will now hand back to Debbie, who's done a sterling job, and she'll just do a round off. Thank you, Debbie.
I just want to say a huge to Mr. Alan Keegan as well for being such a I really hope that you've got some good advice from our panel and that you agree that it was a great discussion. The panel have kindly said that they will stay for a little bit longer outside and partake of some wine with you and do some networking. So please join in for that. You're very welcome to some free wine and some nibbles. So I just want to give a little gift to our panelists here and our chair. Only a small thing, but it's a little thank you from us for giving up your Friday night. It didn't come from X.
It's a football scarf.
Yeah, but you can't guess by the shape what it is. Okay, like I say, the wine and the nipples is outside. By the way, my name's Debbie Williams, and I am, of course, the leader for Masters in Publishing, and, as of last week, the A in Publishing, the only one in the country that is a single honours publishing course. Our interns and our students who really live at the heart of what